Amen and amen and amen. You may be seated in his presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, problems may come. Struggles will be there. Surely it rains on the just and the unjust alike. But the flow from Calvary's cross is a peace that is more reassuring than the sun will rise in the morning. Amen. He said, I would never leave you. I would never forsake you. I will be with you until the end of the age. You may feel alone, but you need never be lonely. God is there with you. Amen. Some of you right now, you know exactly what I'm saying. You may not have another single human being that is really standing beside you like you would have hoped. But I'm telling you, God is with you. If you're a believer, Christ is in you, the hope of glory, by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And God said he'll be with you. When you pass through the waters, you're not going to be overflowed. Through the rivers, he's going to be there. When you go through the fire, he said, don't even worry about it. You won't even smell like smoke. Because you are the redeemed of the Lord. You are his. He calls you by name. He doesn't just say, hey, you're somebody. He says your name. And your name as a believer is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I tell people, when he wrote mine, he wrote it in indelible ink. He doesn't have to worry about erasing it. Amen. To God be the glory, the praise, and the honor. Hallelujah. What a privilege it is to be a son and a servant of the Most High God. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Turn with me to a couple of passages of Scripture this morning in Psalms 133, Amos 3 and 3. You don't have to turn to all of them if you don't like, but you'll be better off if you do. And Ephesians 4 and 13. We're going to try to finish this message today, and I'm going to bring you whatever I can bring you. Is that all right? And we've been talking about for the win. And obviously we've used a sports analogy. And out of that, there are some important things we need to understand that, first of all, God wants us to win. Thanks be unto God who gives us the victory in Christ Jesus. That word gives is in the redundant verb, and it means that he gives and he gives and he gives and he gives. Even when you feel like you're losing, you're still a winner if you're in Christ Jesus. Amen? You may look at it, but God sees the bigger picture. You may feel like you're behind in the race, but you need to know you've already won the race, amen? Sometimes we get this idea that we're moving towards a victory. You have to understand that at Calvary, the victory was won, and you're living in the victory, and we must move in that and understand that, as we sang earlier, according to Acts 17:38, in him we live and move and have our being. Our success has already been determined by his sacrifice in Jesus' name. So in that, we talked about a few things. I think it would have been an inexhaustible subject. So we talked about opportunity. We talked about preparation. We talked about coaching and leadership in our life, no greater than the leadership of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this morning, we're going to talk about a subject that is so important. They're all important, but I don't care what opportunities, I don't care how much you prepare, I don't care what coaching you've had, I don't care what you do, if there is not unity in your life and in the body of Christ, then we simply cannot win. We cannot be victorious. We cannot walk in the fullness of what God has for us in faith if we don't have unity. Unity begins in our relationship with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But understanding that there is more than just our relationship with God, but there is our relationship with one another, and that we must not just be gathered together, but we must be gathered together in one mind, in one accord, in the spirit of truth, in the spirit of righteousness, and yes, at times, in the spirit of reconciliation, because there are times we transgress over one another. Amen? Anybody ever offend you before? Absolutely. Have you ever offended someone before? Certainly you have. And what we have to understand that out of unity, we reconcile with one another in the body of Christ. And so it is out of unity, there is a power that is released. There is an anointing that is released. We talk about the moving of the Spirit. We use terms like the flow of the Holy Ghost. We talk about power and we talk about authority and we talk about the body of Christ and what we need to do. You see, it is not until that we move in unity does the flow of that anointing come. Nobody, no physical body can operate unless all the parts are in sync. Amen? If your right leg says, I want to go to the right because I favor the right, and your left leg says, I want to go to the left because I favor the left, there's going to be pain in certain parts of your body. Amen? Something's going to suffer in the long run. And if you're getting a few years on you, such as myself, probably every part is going to suffer in the long run. But if there is a unity within that body, something great is going to be accomplished. And so it is in the body of Christ, that if we can learn to work together, if we can learn to follow the head and the leadership that God gives unto us, there are no limitations to what we can do in Jesus' name. If we understand the concept of team, that there's no I in team, that it's all about everybody coming together for the betterment of the whole, amen? Working together with a common goal and a common cause to accomplish what God has called us to accomplish. And understanding it's not just being together, but it's being together with the spiritual synergy of what God wants to do in our life. So would you stand with me in honor of God's word this morning? And we look at Psalms 133. The scripture says, I'm going to read out of the King James, if I may, this morning, just for the beauty of it. Behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity, exclamation point. It is like the precious anointment or ointing upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard that went down to the skirts of his garment. As the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. In Amos 3:3, he says a rhetorical question. How can two walk together except they would be in agreement? I've never seen a marriage work that they couldn't ultimately get on the same page. Amen. And in Ephesians 4:13, a powerful passage about the purpose of ministry in the church, of bringing unity and maturity. He said, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect or a mature man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Father, in the name of Jesus, Let your word rest in our heart, in our spirit, and in our mind today. God, let it take seed as in good soil today. Father, I ask for your blessings to communicate the word, and I pray blessings upon every church throughout our community that names the name of Jesus Christ as Lord. Amen and amen. Father, bless your people. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Now, I am very well aware of the time this morning, and I'm not really excessively concerned. I am sensitive. But would you give me enough time to get this word out today? Amen. I kind of need 100% on that. All right. Thank you very, very much. But I promise you, I'll leave out all the boring parts. Don't come to me after church and say, well, you let one go and you kept a little part of that in there. It is so important that we understand the power of unity, that there can be no victory without unity. There can be no full win without unity. And unity is learning that we take the sum of all the parts and they work together for one common goal and purpose. Unity helps us to understand how to love one another. And when we love one another, it lets the world know that we truly are believers and followers of Jesus Christ. It is out of unity that we learn to supersede our struggles because of the divine purposes that God has for our life, because something bigger and greater is there for our life. You know, about 44 years ago, I was playing, I was in sixth grade. Man, that just seems like a long time ago. I went to Addicts Middle School in Dania / Hollywood, Florida. In going to the school, it was a bit of a rough school in a rough neighborhood. They later closed the school down. And up until then, I had never lost any kind of fight whatsoever. I just fought every day, never lost a fight. I was standing in front in fifth period after lunch. I was standing moving towards my advanced algebra class for sixth grade. I was coming to the door, and a guy by the name of George Thomas, who should have been in eighth grade, was standing at the door. And I'm going to give this for illustrative purposes. In fact, he was a tall black gentleman. Gentleman is an exaggeration. I walked up and I said, "Move, boy." Now, I wasn't saved. There was no thought of that. I was a different kind of person. Please forgive me. The next thing I know, he punched me in my eye. I fell back off the concrete in the ledge and laid on the ground and looked up at George Thomas, and I realized there was no winning that fight. So I took my defeat, left, went ahead and did what I needed to do. And for that moment, I hated George Thomas until the next year in seventh grade, when I went to play football again with the Dania Bears. George Thomas came out on that team. And what I realized is that this big guy that punched me in the eye was now on my team and could help me punch other people in the eye. George Thomas became one of my best buddies because now we had a common goal and a common purpose. We never one time talked about that indiscretional punch where he hit me in the eye. I never admitted that he won or that I lost. It was just common understanding that nothing else was going to happen. We became very good friends on the football team. And from that year on, our team started doing quite well. And I believe it was because there was a unity that came together and because George Thomas was really big and strong. But when it was all said and done, I learned that moment that you can supersede anything. You can supersede racial divide. You can supersede your anger at a person or your frustration or whatever it is when you find a greater cause in a greater purpose that you can come together and work towards in accomplishing. Well, to win a football game is a small thing compared to what we can do in life here at Sanctuary Church and in the body of Christ, amen? We can supersede racial divides. We can supersede any type of bigotry and discrimination. We can supersede where we might not like how another person does everything that they do. We may not appreciate all that they do, but we can look at them and say, they are a part of the team of the body of Christ in Christianity, and we can do something greater together than what we could do in a divided way for the cause of Christ. If you believe that, give him praise this morning. So let me give you a few things this morning, if I could quickly. Let me talk about a little bit of the background of unity and how important it is. When you go into the Bible, you look at Genesis 1 and 1. And the Bible said, in the beginning, God made the heavens and the earth. That word God is in the Hebrew, Elohim. It is the only name of God that is used in the creation writing, Elohim. And Elohim is the name for the triune creator of who God is. It means the Trinity, the three. There in creation, it was God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit working together, for they are one. They are not simply in triunity. They are in unity in every way, accomplishing of the work of the Godhead. Now in that, we go back to Psalms 133 and we recognize this is one of the most beautiful passages in the Bible about unity. It is a simile. It is trying to explain to us how important unity is, how God approaches unity, and what God will do when unity is present among his children and fellow believers in Jesus' name. So let me give you a few things under that. First and foremost, he is speaking to us about the beauty of unity. Well, when you listen to what he says, he opens up David and says, behold how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Now, those words, behold, good and pleasant, are very important, because what he's saying is, hey, I need you to focus and look right here. Behold, it's really important. This thing is good. It's pleasant. It's a thing of beauty. It is something that God likens as precious. It is something that we need to focus on, and we need to understand that it is very important. He's opening up with a statement to say, hey, every reader, every person, every Hebrew in that day, the nation of Israel, and all believers to follow, it's for you and I this morning. And we say, behold, look at what I'm about to say. This, what I'm going to say, is so beautiful and so pleasant that it just absolutely is something that God cares greatly and intimately about. You see, I believe it is one of the most beautiful things that when the body of Christ and even a fellowship of believers such as Sanctuary Church learn to flow together as one, learn to get along as one, learn that we are distinctly different, that there is a great diversity among us, but in that diversity, there is a unity, and that the Lord can say, it is a thing to behold. Not only do we get along and come together and work for the common goal and purpose and loving one another, but beyond Sanctuary Church, we learn to love other believers. We say they may have a different title over their door, but we love those Methodist believers. We love those Baptist believers. We love those Assembly of God believers. We love those Catholic believers where the Lord can say, behold, it is a good thing. It is a pleasant thing, meaning that out of that, good things happen. Let me ask you a very simple and rhetorical question. Do you think better things happen when we get along or we argue? Let me ask you as a married man, do you think you're going to have a better day today if you get in a fight with your wife or you have a good unity of fellowship with your wife? Well, obviously, the former over the latter. And this prayer is perhaps one of the most beautiful prayers that has ever been prayed when Christ prayed this thing of unity in John 17, verse 20, 21. When Christ said, just before he goes to Calvary, he's praying in the upper room, and he says to the Father about his disciples, he said, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me. That's us right here this morning. He said that through their word, that they all may be one, as you, Father, and are in me and I in you, that they also may be in one, that the world may believe that you sent me. Jesus said it is so important that as we are one, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, I want that same relationship for my followers, that we would be as one, that we would operate in perfect love, in perfect harmony, and in perfect unity in our lives. We need to understand that out of that, Christ was saying, out of unity, God is glorified, he is magnified, and he is satisfied when his children are unified in the name of Jesus. It is a beautiful thing. Secondly, not only in Psalms do we see its beauty, but we see its basis. You see, unity is not simply something that happens because we came together. There has to be a fundamental basis of that unity. In my life, I've built several homes, and we've been privileged to build several church buildings as well, and even add-on buildings. So I've been around construction, though I'm not a builder in any way. And you know what I found? They'll deliver a lot of product, and that product will all be there. When they delivered all the lumber to build one of our homes, it was just lumber. It just sat there. But until all those boards were put together and connected in their proper place, there wasn't much of the framing of the house. And then they delivered a bunch of shingles. But the shingles were all in the same place, but they weren't in the same purpose until they were put on the roof and they were interconnected. Then they started mattering. Then they delivered brick. Oh, we put beautiful brick on our house in Carolina. It was this kind of real light, white, oversized brick, and the brick was beautiful. But it was just there until they laid the brick and they interconnected all the brick and the mortar tied it together. And when it was all done, there was a unity in the brick that looked so wonderful and so perfect, and it made the house. Let me tell you something. So it is with believers. Just coming together is a good start, but staying together and working together, now we've got unity working on our side. And out of the basis of that, it is to accomplish something greater. And it all begins as sons of God in Jesus Christ. The only way we can get beyond just being together and being something together is we have to be a part of the same family. Amen? And that family is whereby we have one Father, our Heavenly Father. The Bible said in John 1, verse 11 and 12, Jesus came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, gave he the power or the right to be sons of God. How do we connect And how do we just be more than being present? We connect by being sons and daughters of the Most High. How does that happen? By believing in the name of Jesus Christ. It all begins with sonship. The basis of our fellowship is based on a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. And for, go ahead and give him praise. I am pushed at different times in my ministry life where people will say, hey, listen, the world just needs to get along and all churches need to get along and all beliefs need to get along. Listen, I'll get along with anybody that isn't trying to hurt somebody. I can go to dinner with them. I can go to your country. I can laugh with you, whatever we need to do within reason. But what I can't do is I can't unify with you unless we are both born again believers through Jesus Christ. It is only at Calvary can we find true unity. Just because you say, well, we all worship the same God, I'm here to tell you, we don't all worship the same God. I worship the true Jehovah, the Creator, the giver of life, the one that gave his son, Jesus Christ, to die for my sins and pay the price for my penalties. We unify at Calvary based on Jesus Christ. Can you say amen this morning? Secondly, and that basis is not only on sonship, but it's based on God's Spirit. It's interesting to note that David said this unity is like the oil. Now, the Hebrews knew. When you said ointment, when you said oil, when you said anointing, they knew immediately this was not something casual. This was something that was not conditional. This was something that was absolutely a part of their worship and relationship with God the Father. It spoke about this special anointing oil that God had instructed Aaron and the priests to make so that it prepared them to go into the place of worship and it readied them. Aaron, being the high priest, spoke of Jesus, our great high priest, amen. And in that, this anointing was made of four parts: the calamus, the cinnamon, the myrrh, the calamus, the cinnamon, the myrrh, and the frankincense. God bless you, and the frankincense. And so, out of that, out of these four parts that took place, and out of everything, there was this unity. Let me back up. I don't like to do anything biblically that ain't right. It is not frankincense. It is the cassia, okay? Frankincense was for, in the New Testament, when he was anointed, when they brought as a child. Let me get back to the sermon, okay? Calamus, cinnamon, cassia, and myrrh, all right? Very important. Don't ever get that wrong in the sense that God has one type of anointing, and it is the anointing of the Holy Spirit. If anybody made anything else, it was death unto them. And so in that, that anointing spoke in several ways to them. First of all, it was a mixture. It was a blend of fragrances. And out of that blend of fragrances, there was all different types, and it spoke of the differences coming together as one and how that, that anointing would be poured over Aaron from the head. It always starts at the head and it goes all the way down and it covered, it even came across the breastplate, which spoke about the 12 tribes of Israel, and it went all the way to the weakest part, to the feet and to the ground. What is he saying? He's saying that, listen, the unity of the body of Christ is precious. It is that coming together by the Spirit, and it covers the head, it covers the body, it covers the weaker parts, it covers the stronger parts, it covers every single area. And out of that anointing, it is by the Holy Spirit that we can come together because it is Christ in you, it is Christ in me, it is Christ in another person, it is Christ in this black believer, it's Christ in this white believer, it's Christ in this brown believer, it's Christ in this mixture of colored believers, it's Christ in males, it's Christ in females, it's Christ in the rich, it's Christ in the poor, it's Christ in the young, it's Christ in the old, it's Christ in the smart, it's Christ in the not so smart, Christ in the educated and the uneducated, it's Christ in a new believer, it's Christ in an old believer. What are you saying? It's when we receive Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes in us and unifies us as one. It's whether you're the strongest member or the weakest member. All that matters is that you and I are members of the body of Christ, and by the Spirit of God, we can be unified as one in Jesus' name. Paul said in Ephesians 4:3, to keep the unity of the Spirit of the bond of peace. That when we walk in the Spirit, there is a peace that dwells with us. When there are schisms and there are fights in the body, we are saying we're not walking in the Spirit. Can I just get personal? When you talk about another believer, when you talk about another church, when you talk about another ministry, when you talk about another leader and you run that person down, you are saying there is no anointing in my life. I don't care what they did. I don't care who they are. I don't care what's happened in their life. You and I have no right by the Spirit of God to run another person down, to take and criticize another ministry. To God alone they shall stand. He is the judge of every single person in this room and on this earth. And we need to come together and say that by the Spirit of God, we will speak life, we will speak healing, and we will speak reconciliation to all of those who are members of the body of Christ. Can you say amen? Amen and amen. Go ahead and give him praise if you believe that. And the basis is the leadership of God's servant. You know, they say that everything rises and falls on leadership. I believe that to an extent. But I believe that you go further and everything rises and falls not only in leadership but in followership. Because it doesn't matter who the leader is if we're not a good follower. Amen? We have to learn followership. And I'm going to tell you, the book of Joshua teaches us so wonderfully as it opens up. And I'll just give you a little glimpse. As Joshua is now following Moses, Moses has died, God raises up another leader. I'm going to tell you, people struggle with a second leader. People struggle with a new leader. Somebody comes in, you say, oh, I like the old leader. Well, he's dead, you can't follow him. That's just the way. Well, I want Moses. Well, Moses is gone. You got to move on. I want this pastor. He moved. They went somewhere else. It's, what are we going to do, right? We can't change the facts and the circumstance of the situation. God raises up new leaders. He raises up new people. I mean, there's been pastors in my life. They moved on, and I cried, and I wept, and I said, why are you leaving me? I don't understand it. I was new in Christ. It broke my heart. But, you know, God brought new people in here. And I'm not getting ready to tell you anything different. We're still going to be the pastor here. Amen? Is that okay? So with that. But what we have to understand among us, things change. And what we have to understand is fellowship should never change. We should follow the leaders God gives us. In the book of Joshua, Joshua chapter 1, verse 16 and following, when Joshua gave them the plan that God gave them, they said, and they answered Joshua saying, all that you command us, we will do. And wherever you send us, we will go. Just as we heeded Moses in all things, so we heed you. Only the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Let me tell you something. What they said is, hey, listen, God's speaking to you. You're speaking to us. You become the voice of God into our ears. And he said, and they said, and we're going to pray for you that whatever you do, God's leading you. So if you're uncomfortable with something, they're simply saying, pray for that leader. Lift that leader up. Pray God help them to do better and to honor exactly what his word is. Don't talk about them. Don't get upset with them. Don't fuss and fight. And he said, This ain't New Testament, but boy, it'd be cool if it was. It said, whoever rebels against your command and does not heed your words and all that he commands, then we're just going to put him to death. Now, wouldn't that be something? I mean there's parts of me that say, thank God we're New Testament, and there's parts of me that say, that'd be pretty cool. Somebody gets to talking bad, you know, in the body of Christ. You know, somebody gets to running down another church or another member of the body of Christ. And we say, oh, well, we're sorry. We really love you, and you used to be a really good person, but we're going to have to put you to death. We're going to have to stone you to death. No, I'm changing my way. No, too late. We're all Old Testament. Praise God for grace. Amen. He said, only be strong and of a good courage. What is he saying? He's saying, hey, listen, leadership is essential, but fellowship is even more essential. We have to learn to follow the leadership that God places in our life. We have to learn that God puts people there and that God is using those people, and that as believers, and this is a tough thing, it's really difficult, but God never empowers or gives us the right to be rebellious of authority in our life unless that authority takes us away from the Word of God. Amen? We must first obey God, and then we obey those servants. Even at times, we have to understand secular authority in our life is there to help us. Amen. Read Romans 13. So the next time you get a ticket, look at the police officer and say, thank you for being a hand of God. I needed to slow down lest something was coming up the road. You know I do that. Let me close with this. Obviously, just one point. Let me talk about, finally, as you come to the piano, the blessing of unity. David compares unity to the oil that flows, and then he compares it to the dew on Mount Hermon. It's funny because he references Mount Hermon and Mount Zion. It's just two different references to the same thing. That's all. It's the same thing. It's speaking of the Mount of God. Mount Hermon, the tallest point in Palestine. I've been there. It's beautiful. Oh my goodness. In northern Israel. It's just gorgeous. And as you're driving away and you see the snow-capped mountains, and you just recognize what David is saying, man. And he talks about the dew. Now, in that Mediterranean area, and especially in those days, they didn't have the irrigation and the pipes and the water systems that we have. They were dependent upon that dew. It was a life-giving essential. And on Mount Hermon, there was just a special amount of dew, and even the snow-capped mountains, that when that melted and that came down, it not only, get this, it not only blessed that region, but that blessing flowed down and blessed other areas and other farmers. Let me tell you something, that when there is unity in the body of Christ, when there is unity in a marriage, when there is unity among fellow believers in churches, it not only blesses us, but it flows down and it blesses others. It blesses far beyond our church. It blesses our community. It blesses the state of Florida. And if you get that unity and you're going further, this nation needs to come back into a place of unity. And I'm going to tell you where it begins. It doesn't begin at the White House getting the right president. Just let me tell you, we'll never get the right president to do what we're wanting him to do. What we need to do is get the unity that starts right here among us and let it flow out. And if believers can start coming together, not only localized but nationwide, it'll affect this nation. And presidents will do the things that God is leading them to do. And congressmen will say the right things. And they'll think, where did that come from? It came from unity. That dew that's flowing down from the top is affecting everyone else. And as that dew came down and it touched, the crops were given life. And the dew affected the crops that gave life, that put food on the table, that put clothes on people's back, that blessed households that blessed one another, that not just a few were blessed, but everyone was blessed because the dew that came down and what dew does for the land, unity does for the body of Christ and bringing us together as one in Jesus Christ. It is the fruitful blessing that because of unity, not just one is blessed, but all is blessed. And I believe that God is saying that when you learn to come together and speak together and love one another as I have loved you, there is going to be a release of my anointing. In the latter part of verse 3, he said, it is where the Lord commanded the blessing. God bless us. Answer our prayers. I believe God says, yeah, but I want you to answer my prayer. My son prayed in John 17 that they may be one. Tommy Tenney wrote in his book some years ago about the unity of faith and said, the only prayer that was never answered of Christ is John 17, the prayer of unity. It's the last prayer that is awaiting to be answered for Jesus Christ until we all come in the unity of faith. Amos said, how can we walk together except we be agreed? How can we be agreed except we first come under a surrendered banner? Jehovah Nissa, the banner of the Lord is over all of us, amen? Not just some of us, but all believers. We come under that banner and we say we will have faith under that banner. We will fight together, not with each other, but we will fight against darkness and unrighteousness and those things that the enemy brings. Together, we will supersede because the causes of the kingdom are greater than the problems in life. We will learn to stand together and we will learn to come together. It reminds me of the ship captain took out some folks to go deep sea fishing. The guy was fishing and he hit a really, really big fish. Man, the pole started squealing, the spool was spinning. He tried to lock it up, and the fish pulled him in the water. The guy starts screaming, I can't swim! The boat captain patiently comes over there. He reaches down and he grabs the guy by the arm and he pulls. And his arm came off. He had a prosthetic arm. He says, oh no! And the guy's yelling now, I can't swim, help me! So the boat captain reaches down and he grabs him by the leg. And he pulls his leg and up comes a leg. He had a prosthetic leg. And the guy says, oh no. And he's still yelling now. Help me. I can't swim. The boat captain reaches down. He said, I'll get him. And he grabs him by the hair and he yanks to pull him up. And off comes his toupee. I'm not insulting anybody here. Off comes his toupee. Now he's got an arm, a leg, and a handful of hair. And the guy's now screaming, help me, I can't swim. And the guy said, I'll help you if you'll just hold yourself together. I believe God will help us if we'll just hold ourselves together. Amen. We may be different. Go ahead and give him praise. We may be different, but don't let our differences separate us. You eat different food than I can't eat half of what some of you guys eat. I mean, just spicy and oh my lands. I can't even smell curry that I don't get sick. That's just the way it is. And some of you, oh, it's the best thing you could ever want. Well, go ahead, have at it. But I still love you, amen? You know, I've got some weird issues in my life. Don't ask my wife. She'll tell you. But we can supersede them, and we can come together in faith. In Jesus' name. Now, what are we going to do? Well, I missed out on giving you a plethora of scriptures, but it's time to close it out. You got to make a decision. I don't have to give you another 40 scriptures to get you to understand. This is God's word. The Lord is saying, I will release my blessing. I will command my blessing when you come together in unity. Not just being together. EJ, come here for a second, please. Bill, come on here for a second, please. You could not get three people more different than us three. Bill's smart enough, he don't wear a toupee. This is not, hold on one second. This is not unity. There's no unity here yet. Nothing is going to happen. But when I come together and we begin to lock as a link, something happens where there's strength that is involved. There's power. There's enablement. We can do more together. Ecclesiastes 4 says that two are better than one, and a threefold cord is not easily broken. We're stronger together. We become mature according to Ephesians 4, 13 through 18. Maturity is developed. Perfection is developed, which is teleos, which means maturity. When we are together, that's a part of coming together. It is learning to stay together. It is learning to work together. It is learning to say, you're different than I am. You're not as tall. You're really hairy. We do have the same color shoes. You're very handsome, but you're different than me. But I need you, and I got to work with you if we're going to get something done. And it's got to be more than a superficial. It has to be something that is felt into the heart, because the anointing works from the inside out. That's why it's so important that he said it's that anointing. It's not from the outside in. It's not saying, well, I got to join with you. I don't really like you because you're different. I don't like you because of this and that. It's saying, I love you because from the inside out, I want to connect with you and I want to do something great for the kingdom of God. And you reach over and you say, you know, Bill, you're a little bit older than I am. How old are you?
32.
Okay, Bill, you're almost 50, 45 years older than, but you both have a beard, you just dye yours a different color. You know, you both have hair, you just do the horseshoe thing. But you grab a hold of them and you say, listen, young fella, we're in the body of Christ. I'm not above you. I'm not greater than you. I'm serving with you. I'm serving in the equality of Calvary's cross. You may be an elder in the church and you may be working and leading in the youth group, but we're not bigger above and beyond one another. We're equal together in Jesus' name, and we're going to do something together that's going to make a difference in Orlando. Can you say amen? Amen and amen. So, thank you guys. So what are you going to do? Let's be changed from the inside out. Let that anointing flow into our heart and change us and unify, not just because we come together, but let us unify in our attitude and our spirit. Let us realize we're all different, but in our diversity there should be a unity. Not a uniformity, but a unity of purpose, mind, and spirit. In Jesus' name, Father, right now, bring us together out of a heart of love and service to the Father. Let us realize that we find unity not because we found a church, but because we discovered a faith in the same Heavenly Father. As we are born again, we are born to win. And that win is unity. For the win, we come together, we work together, and we stay together, Father. Help us to realize that some may make mistakes, but we won't disclude them. Some may express their talents differently, but we don't discount them. But we realize we need every member of the team working together. There's some John Alexanders and there's some George Thomases. But when we find out we can make a difference if we work together, God, we just become the sons and servants of the Most High. In Jesus' name. I'm going to ask you to do something this morning. Heads bowed, eyes closed for just a minute. In the very beginning of this message, I said, unity is discovered first and foremost through Jesus Christ. I want to be on your team and I want you on my team. And the only way that happens is that we're both saved in Jesus' name. There's some here this morning right now. You're not where you need to be in Jesus Christ. You may have never accepted Christ. God loves you. He wants you a part of His kingdom and a part of His plan. God wants to bless you. I want to work with you. I want to grow with you. I don't care how good or bad or what color. It doesn't matter. God wants to save you this morning. If you've gotten away from the Lord, God wants to restore you. If that's you this morning, you want to say, I want to come back to Jesus. I want you to slip your hand up where you're at. Just right where you're at. Just slip your hand up and say, Pastor, I want you to pray for me this morning. I want God to restore me in faith. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen and amen. God bless you. You can put your hand right back down. How many this morning as well would say, Pastor, I want to walk in the fullness of the unity of faith. And I want God to use me in this church and in the body of Christ to be a unifying element in the kingdom work. If that's you, just stand right now and say, God, use me. All over this church, just stand if that's you. I just want to be a part of the unity of faith. I want to help. I want to do whatever God would have me to do. I want to build up one another. Let me tell you, it's really a rhetorical question. I'm speaking to every single believer in this place that would simply say, Lord, I'm willing to open my heart and be unified with other believers. I'm willing to lay aside all of the differences. I'm willing to do whatever it takes. I want to work together with every single believer. I want to work together with believers outside of this vineyard, outside of this church, outside of this ministry. I just want to work together with other believers. Could you, in the name of Jesus, just reach over and for just a minute, just lock arms with someone else. Just reach over and lock arms with someone else. And I want you to just begin to understand that your strength is holding you together, but what really holds us together is His strength. What keeps us, you two ladies, you're strong, you're inseparable, but it's not based on your ability to lock your arms, though that's a beautiful thing. It's your ability to join your faith in the power of the Spirit that dwells in you, and the power of the Spirit that dwells in you has come together and say, we may be different, but we're more alike than we realize because we're one in Jesus Christ. We're in the same family. We have the exact same Father. You and I, the three of us, we're triplets. We got the same Father. Jesus Christ has redeemed us, and we're heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ, and we find our strength not because of our strength, but because of the unity of our faith in Jesus Christ. I want you to pray for that person right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, as we lock together, God, as we come together, we illustrate it with our arms, but God, we orchestrate it by Your Spirit in us, working through us, bringing us together. Father, right now, forgive us, cleanse us, God, of anything that would separate us in Jesus' name. Help us to operate as one in the body of Christ and to fulfill Your purposes, Your destiny, Your design for our life. God, I believe that when we will walk in unity, You will command a blessing on this church and community like there has never been before. There will be a revival. There will be miracles that will take place. And there is no greater miracle than the saving grace of Jesus Christ. There is no greater power than that of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we say as we come together, it will release your power. It will be like dew that flows, God, from heaven, that will come and touch and minister to every single person. God, even unbelievers will be benefited until they find the convicting power of Calvary in their life. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. If you prayed that, give him honor and glory. I'm going to ask one last thing. Those that raised their hand and said, I want to give my life to Jesus Christ, or I want to rededicate my life to Christ. I've stepped down from this platform. I've come to this place. I'm asking you, would you meet me right here this morning? Would you just step out of your seat? Would you have enough faith to say, I want you to pray for me, Pastor, and I want God to do a restoring work in my life right now? I'll wait here for just a minute. Amen. Those that lifted your hands, if you'd just come right now. In the name of Jesus, Sanctuary Congregation, would you just welcome? Amen. Those that come, in the name of Jesus.
Good to be back.
Amen. Amen. Bless you. Bless you. Bless you so much in the name of Jesus. We love you, but we are unified with you only through the faith that we have in Jesus Christ. God is working right now in your hearts. The Bible said, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whatever's in your past, from this day forward is behind you. Amen, church? It's behind you. Would you stretch your hands this way? Would you pray this prayer with me right now? Pray it aloud. Father, amen, amen. In the name of Jesus, we come to you and we confess that we are sinners and we cannot save ourselves. We acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world and the Son of God. This morning, I ask you, Jesus, to come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Be my Savior, that from this day forward, I will be a Christian in the body of Christ. Let your anointing flow over my life and give me the strength to live for you. In Jesus' name I pray. I'm saved. I'm delivered, and I'm set free in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Now, listen, Audrey is going to take you right over here and share some things with you. Here's the beautiful thing. First of all, we welcome you back into the body of Christ. We welcome you this moment, but as well. Yes.
I called the Harbor House, domestic violence, you name it, coalition, everybody. And all the people that helped me was this church.
Praise God.
And
praise God.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank
amen.
You so much.
Amen. 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 For those in the back, I believe it bears repeating. She came to the church, and out of her words, she's been in an abusive relationship, battered. And she tried all sorts of different agencies, and none offered any help. And she said that the church was able to help her this week. And what a great ministry. It's our honor and privilege to be a part of helping you. And now, more than anything else, just welcome to the family of God.
Thank you.
We love you. We love you. Amen. Amen. Audrey, if you would just... Amen. One last thing as we're being, go ahead, as we're being dismissed. Jeff Morgan, could you come here for a minute, my friend? I I know we did it once, but we're going to do it again. Right. Jeff, his wife is already in Georgia, and up there waiting on him. Is this your last Sunday?
Yeah.
Okay.
I leave Tuesday.
He leaves Tuesday. Jeff is just a tremendous man of God and faith and service and work, and been a part of this church for almost eight years, but he's been a part of the kingdom of God for 30-some years, right? And actually, he got saved in Joe Moore, who attends this church, when he was pastoring 30 years ago on the east side of Orlando. So it's a beautiful thing. But Jeff is claiming to retire, and he's moving to Georgia, which, if I know Jeff at all, he's still going to work and do things and do ministry. But I want us to just stretch our hands, and maybe I can get some elders to come up this morning. We want to just pray over Jeff and let him know, first of all, that we love him so much. He is an incredible, he and his wife, incredible people. They have made an incredible impact in this church and ministering and caring for us in really one of the great areas, and that is in the catering business, in the food business, and we know how important that is. But we want to bless him, all right? So would you extend your hands this way? Father, God, we love Jeff and Wanda so much. They're special, and they're incredible, godly people. They're such an instrumental and integral part of the body of Christ. They've lifted us up, and they've brought great increase in this church, in this family. He's always a part of us, God, though he's going to go to Georgia. I pray, protect them, bless them, give them favor, help them to have the relaxation they need and deserve, and let the joy of the Lord ever continue to keep them. I pray they find a good, Spirit-filled, Bible-preaching church that they can join with and covenant with and grow with, and that they can use their gifts and talents to minister in that church as they have here. We pray, God, for their family, God, and where they're going to be at, and their grandchildren. We bless them, and we just pray, God, let your peace forever be sustained in their life, and your prosperity be enjoyed in their family. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Love you, buddy. God bless you so much. God bless you. Shake hands. Be friendly. Let's have a great day, and let's just walk in the unity of the Spirit. Love you so much.
All right, if you're here for the first time today, when you head out the back, make sure you turn right, head toward the cafe. Our guest reception staff would like to give you a free gift, and thank you for coming. Also, remember, this Wednesday, we've got family night, so be here at 7 o'clock. We got something for the whole family. Y'all have a wonderful week.